Hi, welcome to our broadcast. My name is Bernie Dehler, and today I'm talking with Becky Garrison. Hi, Becky.
Hi there, how you doing?
Pretty good, I can see you, so it looks like you're online.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Becky is a religion reporter. She's also written a few books, and today we're going to talk about the supernatural and naturalistic worldviews from our experience. We have both attended seminary, so you might say we probably know more about Christianity than the average American, because we had to think about this for our school subjects. So Becky, I'm going to start with you, and I'll let you have a few minutes. You wrote a number of books. You can tell the audience about a few of your books and see if that's interesting to them. It'll kind of also set the stage for what kind of a writer you are.
Well, the first book that I wrote was Red and Blue God, Black and Blue Church, and that book was written after the 2004 presidential election, and I was noticing this shift of towards partisan politics on both the left and the right, where they were trying to replicate their own version of Jesus and insert it into partisan politics. So this was a plea for churches and Christians to stop doing that and start following, if they wanted to, the teachings of Jesus instead of the whims of the Democratic or Republican Party. It was the beginnings of the stirrings of my ancestor, Roger Williams. And then another book I've written was, there's a book called Starting from Zero with Zero. That was a book that on initial glance looks like it's geared for churches wanting to start grassroots, you know, ministries, but it has some practical information in there. For example, there's an interview with one of the people who did Obama's Ohio, you know, social media campaign. So it's an interesting thing. What do you do if you have very little money or scant money, and yet you really want to do some interesting and innovative ministries, whether it's Sunday assembly or whether it's a Christian church? What do you do if you don't have the bucks? And the most recent book I did was my first ebook. It's the first time I walked away from the professional, quote-unquote, Christian world, and like my ancestor Roger Williams, I became a seeker. So this was called Roger Williams' Little Book of Virtues. And the question was, what might happen if we all decide to follow the teachings of Roger Williams, who people might not realize he crafted the first charter in Western civilization that granted religious liberty to everyone, including atheists?
I've never heard of Roger Williams. So
look him up. He's a pretty interesting guy.
So how would you describe your belief system now then?
I would say that, like a lot of people in mainline, you know, denominations, is kind of moving away from a supernatural view of God. I did have a little bit of a kind of a conversion experience of some sorts in my 20s. And what I now realize was happening with a lot of the research that's going on is that what I was feeling wasn't really maybe the Holy Spirit coming down and blessing me, but a feeling of compassion. You know, Karen Armstrong's been writing a lot about this research. There's been a lot of studies going on of what happens when you're in a group and you're receiving a lot of positive experience. And some people attribute that to saying, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit of Jesus, I'm filled with Jesus' love. And it turns out what you're really filled with is the fact that you're in a group of people that really care about you. That's a very profound and feeling that should never be discounted.
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of things you can conflate with religion that aren't really true, or with Christianity. Like, you know, when I think about my born-again experience, I was around college age, and I remember thinking about these things, and I was like, my eyes were open, I'm seeing all these spiritual truths. But looking back, now that I'm an atheist, it was really just an awakening, like a consciousness awakening about, you know, like with existentialism philosophy, coming to grips with your mortality. And Christianity, you know, they bring this mortality to the front of your brain when they say, like, you know, you could die tonight. What's going to happen to you if you die? So that puts you in a certain mindset to think about those things and bring some awareness. And so I was conflating that experience I was having with, you know, spiritual truths and spirituality and everything. But, you know, if I would have known about existentialism philosophy, you know, I would have, you know, not thought that.
And I think a lot of it has to do with, I think that what they're looking for is the rise of some kind of communities to know what they want to care. I mean, nobody really wants to go to a conference and hear a bunch of academic lectures. That can be intellectually stimulating, but what if you've actually had a really spiritual crisis? A lot more people are disconnected from their families. They're living longer. Over half of Americans live by themselves now, and they're looking for some kind of a community. They want to know, does my life give a damn? Does anybody really care about me? And this is something that churches at their best are excellent at providing this kind of social support and built-in community for those who do not have a functional family, which happens to be a lot of us.
Now, you went to seminary, that's right?
Yeah, I went to Yale Divinity School.
Which one, Yale?
Mm-hmm.
Now, can you tell us, why did you go to seminary? Was it because you wanted to be a preacher or something?
Well, I entered thinking that I was having these religious experiences, and what do I do with these religious experiences? Well, you go up to seminary, and, you know, you want to try to impart this material to other people. In the process, it wasn't I had a deconstruction of my faith, but I learned that I was way too much of a smartass to ever be a priest. I was much better as a prophet sitting off in the back, you know, critiquing the institutional church instead of being part of the institutional church. That was a very big revelation that I had. But also, a lot of the teaching that you do learn in seminary, you begin to deconstruct this simplistic Christianity that you're taught, especially at a mainline seminary. You're taught how to do historical critical research. And once you begin to dissect this and realize, okay, this is a myth, but it still can have meaning. I mean, you can still find meaning in myths, but it doesn't mean that you want to take any of this literally. Fortunately, I came from the Episcopal tradition, so I didn't really have the literalist background that a lot of evangelicals do.
You know, some fundamentalist preachers, I don't know if you've heard this or not, but they warn their people about going to seminary. They say, you know, there's a joke that they call them cemeteries because people go there and their faith dies. Have you heard about that criticism about seminary, that they kill the faith of students?
Well, at that time, when I was going to seminary, I was actually attending a Campus Executive Ministries, which is part of Campus Crusades Bible study. And the reason I was doing that is I liked the community. It was a large group of young adults. It was a chance to meet a lot of, you know, you're in your 20s, you're young, you're single. There's a lot of really nice guys that were definitely non-creeps. And I was told when they discovered I was looking at going to Yale, people did pull me aside and say, you know, they tried to get me to go to a quote-unquote Bible-based seminary, even though Yale is affiliated with a congregational church. It's just not affiliated with the correct evangelical kind of church. So, yes, I've heard that kind of language used a lot.
So, is it true? I mean, in my case, it's kind of funny because I ended up leaving the faith about a year or two later. And you know, I think it's kind of a paradox. Personally, I believe that it's probably easier to leave the faith if you've been seminary trained, because what happens is those who don't go to seminary, they have spiritual questions and they just maybe ask their pastor, and the pastor might say something, and they think to themselves, you know what, I don't understand what's going on here, but my pastor is smarter than me, and he tells me not to worry, that everything's basically, there's answers for some of these things, and it's okay with him, and he knows more than I do, so it must be okay. But when you're seminary trained, you kind of know that, you know, you kind of know what you know, don't know, and you kind of know what other people don't know. So, you know, if you don't know the answer, you know they don't either. So it's kind of like, why do I believe this anymore? So,
but see, for me, it was always about being an Anglican. We were always allowed to be asking questions. I just started asking a lot more questions. And fortunately for me, I was going to seminary at a time when there was a lot of upheaval in the mainline church. And it was really exciting to start covering it when all of a, you know, sudden they're now discussing, how do we welcome LGBT people? You know, the whole issue of marriage, which is a huge issue for the church. How do we, you know, marry people of the same gender who are want to form loving relationships? Do we deny ordination to people that we think want to serve the church? So it was a very exciting time, I think, in the watching how the church was trying to respond or not respond to the different cultural shifts. Mm-hmm. And that's been exciting for me. And to watch the rise of LGBT theologians, non-Western theologians, people of color, and how they're adding their own different interpretations onto this. And it's a shift I'm seeing in theology away from the divinity of Jesus and looking at what does it mean to be the social teachings of Jesus? What happens if you put those teachings into action? And it's really, I find it exciting to watch churches participating in that kind of a work. That to me is interesting and worth watching.
How do you label yourself? If somebody says, like if there's a religious survey and it says, write down your religion, what would you write down?
I usually just say other, or, you know, I mean, I wouldn't go with none, but it's just I don't fit the cookie cutter definition of Christian. I might put down Anglican, apophatic, agnostic, depending on what kind of day I'm in and what kind of mood I'm in and if there's a little blank where you can fill in something else, I would put that in. Because I really describe myself that way. I love the Anglican ritual. I will always be drawn to that. I find it's, you know, walking a labyrinth to me is such a calming, healing experience. That's why I love the Pacific Northwest. It's such, to get in touch with nature to me is very, very, you know, just stimulating and exciting. And I say I'm apophatic because I like to embrace the mystery. When I'm going kayaking, I don't look around and say, oh, look what God created. But it's like, wow, there's something really spectacular about, to me, being in nature, just looking at this around and going, just wow. You know, having one of those kind of Carl Sagan wow experiences. And I say agnostic because a lot of the times I think the best answer you can give is, I don't know. We don't know. And I think that that's a state of living in. And if you look throughout the history, there was a period when the church actually embraced the mystics who kept saying, I don't know. We've always had a very strong history of agnosticism in church history. It's just been kind of squelched by the American, you know, American evangelicalism that really started to rise after the Civil War and really codified itself during, you know, the Eisenhower administration when it became, you know, Christianity versus communism.
Now, why would you also, if somebody were to say that, yeah, I know Becky, she's a Christian, would that bother you to be associated like that, or
don't care? The only time I think if somebody said Becky's an evangelical, I'd be really upset. Nobody says I'm a Christian anymore. They kind of don't say that. But it doesn't really, I mean, I've been called every name in the book. I mean, I've been called, you know, for critiquing some of the emergent church boys, I got called troll, hack, Hitler.
I was wondering if you thought it would be a misrepresentation if somebody said you were a Christian. Would you say that's the wrong characterization for me?
I've made it clear that I've left the professional Christian world, that I no longer identify myself professionally as a Christian. And I think that's a very important distinction because you're finding a lot of Christians who are kind of trying to play in the Christian world. They're trying to, can I be cool and still be Christian? You know, look at me, I've got my tattoos. Look at me, I'm a hipster. And I'm trying, but yet I want my Christian book publishing contract. So I pretty much walked away from all of that. So I would say I tend not to be classified as a Christian in that sense, but I mean, I still do occasionally like to go to an Anglican ritual. I mean, I don't seek the services out, but there's some places where if I know of some people that are doing a service and it speaks to me, I like to go and embrace the mystery on occasion.
Okay, have you thought much about, one thing I wanted to talk about was the supernatural versus a natural worldview. Have you thought much about that in your own life?
Yeah, I haven't, and that's what I was saying. When I go kayaking, I used to say, wow, look what God created. Look at this came down from God. And now I just have much more of a wow attitude. I can't explain this, but wow, look at that nature. I mean, that is just something really spectacular. So
that's a huge change, yeah.
No, so I think you just look and say, I don't know where this came from.
Huh.
You know, but wow, this is absolutely spectacular. And it's also like if something really bad happens to me, I don't say, well, God punished me, but God's punishing me.
Oh, yeah.
It's just,
so you used to be like that sometimes? Like if something bad's going on, do you wonder if it was the devil or God doing it?
Well, not that quite so much, but it would be more like if I said, well, someone says, I'll pray for you, you know, and I'll say, you know, that I believed in the power of prayer. And now what I think it is the power of community. I think knowing that people care about you, that people are concerned about you, that people have your best interests at heart can make you feel good and can help you to get out of bed if you're having one of those really just horrible, rotten days. You know, you're going through a lot of, you know, rejection. You're going through a really rough period, knowing people care about you. So I no longer tell people I'm going to be praying for them. I just say, you're in my thoughts, because I think that's a more honest scenario. I don't believe that if you pray for something, it's going to happen. Like someone will say, you know, let me pray on this and I'll see if I get some money tomorrow. You may get money, you may not get money. But I have noticed that when I'm trying to do good, you know, and when I'm trying to, like, when I do my reporting and I'm trying to be honest, I'm trying to have integrity, things sometimes come my way and sometimes they don't. You know, I just continue plowing through and try to have a positive outlook. And by doing that, I find that when I have a positive outlook, the negative things don't bother me as much as when I'm already down in the dumps, then, like, every little thing will just continue to bother you more. So it's not a question of saying, you know, the prayer is not going to produce a good result or a bad result.
Do you pray anymore at all?
I would say I meditate, but I would call, like, just relaxing and being calm and being still. I think it's very, very, you know, interesting and exciting. There's a number of different meditation techniques I've been looking into. I think that something like, you know, connecting, looking at the whole connection between spirituality and sensuality, I think that's a very interesting field. I've only explored Tantra a little bit, but I think it's very interesting to see what, the more and more you get in touch with your own body, what, you know, and then you get in touch with what I would say, you know, an energy outside of your body. If that, and it's not a New Agey thing. It's just the more I'm in tune with myself, and the calmer I am, the happier I am, and it just feels like I'm emitting a positive energy that other people pick up on and happen to make it a better day. I mean, I don't think that's a supernatural thing. It's just where it, you know, it's just a change in attitude.
What do you think you would do if you're in a situation like a bank robbery or something like that, and your life was threatened? Would you, and you were almost to the point of despair, would you cry out to God in a prayer, you think, to be saved?
No, I would probably find a way to try to kick the guy in the nuts, but, you know, I mean, I would be thinking strategically how to save my life.
I was in a debate once, and a woman asked me that, and I thought, well, you know, that'd be a waste of time to, you know, she goes, what if you're in a boat sinking, you know, and I thought, well, you know, if you're praying, that's going to take away time from trying to think about how to get saved or something. And, you know, you can save yourself if you think about it.
I mean, one thing I would probably try to do, depending on the situation, is I do think if you can try to remain calm to the best extent you can, but that's different than prayer. I mean,
right.
I would think it's like, how do I not flip out and freak out if I'm in a state of crisis?
But you know, what was interesting is it was about a year or two later after that, I did find myself, I rented a boat, and I was with my family, and we were out in a bay on the ocean, around Orca Island and Orcas Islands, and the waters got really choppy, and I was actually really scared. I thought we were going to probably sink, and I was, like, ready to give up, like, come on, Coast Guard, you know, come get me or something. But it's like, well, there's no Coast Guard, nobody's here. I'm just going to have to power through it. So we hit these big waves, and my kids were in the front going, yay, yay, like, this is fun, you know. And it's like, I'm not going to say anything because, you know, if I wanted to, you know, if I was going to say something, I'd say, like, you know, you guys better be careful because you might die here or something. And that's the way I felt. But it was pretty scary, but it was kind of funny. It's like, I wish I could pray, but I'd be like saying, you know, for me to pray, it'd be like somebody to seriously think about trying to do a magic from a Harry Potter book or something. I mean, you know it's real, so you can't even do it, although you kind of wished you could, but you know it ain't going to accomplish anything.
Well, and that's, I think it's part of the sadness. Like when I was part of the professional Christian world, you know, people would want you to endorse their products. You would blog on each other's guest blogging, and it would be a little bit of a camaraderie. But I realized that a lot of that stuff wasn't really built on a real friendship. It was based on a shared interest, as long as we all tow the same
networking, yeah.
You know, and it's like professional networking. You know, we're all right. In this profession, and we happen to like. But the moment you leave that profession, nobody wants a thing to do with you. I guess it'd be similar if you were a musician and you decided to leave the music industry. You would discover that a lot of your musician friends aren't around. It's just in the Christian world, sometimes because you're sharing spiritual truths and you're sharing personal information, it can feel, for some people, like they're losing their family. I mean, as I was telling you, I was researching this implosion that is the Mars Hill Church, and one of the biggest problems people are having is as they leave the church, a lot of them were drawn to the church because this religious leader was like a father figure to them. And they had their own dysfunctional family history, and all of a sudden, they're losing their father again. You know, mm-hmm. There could be some very profound experiences that people go through when they're actually leaving a church, and especially when they leave a church and then the people say, well, now you're going to hell. Well, your dad just told you you're going to go to hell after your real dad already abandoned you. So it's a double abandonment for someone who's already in an emotional and vulnerable state.
Well, that seems kind of difficult for an evangelical Christian to try to put that threat on another Christian, you know, about leaving the church and going to hell, because it seems like, and I thought in American culture, it's, especially for evangelicals, it's pretty easy to flip from church to church if you wanted to.
But you're told that this is the truth and the way and the light. This is where all your friends are. This is where your family is. This is the church that actually preaches the truth. I mean, if you notice, a lot of evangelicals will say, unlike those other churches down there, we're going to be preaching the actual truth. And, you're finding people will say that there's a very hard line. You need to get on your knees, and you're okay. I've actually seen Mark Driscoll and a few other preachers will say, "Well, are your knees really rough and raw? Because have you been on, you know, your knees praying to Jesus enough? Have you been, you know, really just asking Him to please forgive you, you wretched poor little sinner?" And because I was Episcopalian, they always would believe that we're all created good in the image of God, and I think that's the kind of mindset that makes it easier to start asking questions and to start venturing out and to start exploring versus coming from a background where you believe that you're a useless piece of crap. I mean, you know, it's a completely different mindset. And it's, I think, but I do think that even among the liberal church, and Greta Vosper is a good example for this, a lot of the liberal clergy are now coming to the realization that they cannot believe in what their denomination says are the basic core tenet beliefs. You know, the clergy project has grown to close to 500 people.
Right.
17 when it was founded in 2011. And, you know, have Ryan Bell discovering, is there going to be, you know, what is it like to live for a year without God? And Greta Vosper may be setting a trend as being a minister who is working as an atheist, but working for the United Church of Canada. You know, can the churches look at someone's faith evolves, is that always going to mean they have to leave the pulpit?
Yeah, for those who don't know, the Clergy Project is a, you might say, a ministry set up for people who are in the church, pastors, and they don't believe anymore, and they're trying to figure out how to get out, and, you know, they have to figure out how to make a new living and meet friends and everything. And yeah, I actually know a person who's a former pastor, too, and he's struggling, you know, trying to come out to his family, and he works in the construction business, so it's a little bit easier, but, you know, it's easier than not being a pastor, but, you know, there's a lot of pastors who are stuck.
Yeah, and I think that's going to be an interesting trend for covering, you know, religion, you know, the rise of the nuns, you know, with 1 in 5 Americans saying, what is your religious belief? Well, nothing, and then it's 1 in 3 when you have young adults. So you have all these, you know, no matter how hipster, emergent, progressive, whatever you make it, people are now looking to be finding something else. But they're not necessarily going to atheism. Sometimes they just want to say, I just want to just be nothing. I just want to kind of just be left alone.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have 2 questions for you, okay? Sure. So one is about haunted houses, but the first one is about agnosticism. So it sounds like you wouldn't mind being called an agnostic, being labeled an agnostic. Is that right?
No, but I think that I would also add the Anglican and the apophatic to it. I'm not okay. Agnostic every day. I mean,
what do you think about people, especially atheists, have said this, that an agnostic is just like a wimpy atheist. You know, they're afraid to admit what they are. What do you think of that?
No, because I think there are people that want to embrace the mystery and say, I don't know. You know, mm-hmm. And they want to live in that. They want to live in that tension. I think that I am someone who's very much been attracted to ritual. When I walk on a labyrinth, I don't know what I'm feeling something. I'm not going to attribute it to God per se, but I'm feeling something that is kind of like when I meditate, is putting me in a state of calm, and I'm fully aware that this is a natural state I'm putting myself into. But sometimes I do feel there are the things that we cannot explain, and that's why I'm willing to sit with the questions.
Yeah, I know. I can't remember the guy's name, but he's kind of a famous agnostic too, and I think there's actually a really strong agnostic position where basically the attitude is, you know, I don't know and I don't think anybody knows. And so, you know, if you say there is a God or if you say there's not a God, both of you are, you know, really saying things that you don't know.
And in many ways, that's been embracing the mystics. When I first started as a young adult looking into Christianity, I always embraced the mystics of John of the Cross, Cloud of the Unknowing. These kind of works always spoke to me, and they still speak to me, you know, that there's this thing that we do not know.
Actually, for me though, I'm a pretty strong atheist, and I actually want to. I have this project in my mind. I want to work on this question that, you know, a lot of people say you can't prove the non-existence of God, and I have a different idea. I think you can demonstrate it pretty well. So I'm looking forward to my own time trying to develop that idea. So my next question for you, you know, one thing I say is one time I was talking to my family about how I don't believe anymore, and I have a sister, and she goes, you don't believe in God? Well, what about the devil? You know, it's like, well, of course I don't believe in the devil. But, you know, from her aspect, she's thinking like, okay, well, you know, don't believe in God, but what about the devil? Because, you know, there's always bad things in the world. And also people feel spooky, you know, and or spooked out. And one of the things I've always said is, like, you know what, if the supernatural world was real, it shouldn't be difficult to find a haunted house. Let's find a haunted house. I'd love to spend the night at a haunted house. I'd call the ghosts out. I'd say, come on, ghosts, let's go. What do you got? Show me yourself, you know. Let's do it. But there's no haunted houses anywhere I could do that at.
I don't really go for that. I think a lot of that is projection. It's been proven with a lot of psychics, and a lot of people can manipulate people's fears. And there's also a very strong connection of people wanting to speak to the dead and people like John Edwards who clearly take advantage of that. But I would say we can't ignore the fact that there is this presence of evil. You know, what makes someone a sociopath, a psychopath? You know, what is, it's almost like someone's inner soul or their inner personality just turned off. You know, what turns someone into an Adolf Hitler or a Jeffrey Dahmer? There, I do believe there are things that can turn someone to where whatever semblance of humanity they had seems to be gone. I mean, that has been known to happen, and it is a psychological phenomenon. We do have people that are just known to be psychopaths and sociopaths.
Yeah. But you know, if the supernatural world really did exist, especially in a Christian kind of theology, wouldn't you, if that was really true, wouldn't you expect to see things like demonic possession? I mean, you know, in other countries, a lot of demonic possession reports, but, you know, in America, they don't, the doctors don't ever say this person's demonic or,
well, the thing is, if you don't have the psychological training, this is what we're getting into. I was saying earlier about compassion, is that as you study more about the brain science and different things, you begin to understand what it was. I mean, there was a period of time when, you know, we were basically, you know, bloodletting. We thought that was, you know, the acceptable way to treat an illness. Thanks to Freud, began to realize that we don't just house people. We can do a form of talk therapy. With advances in psychology and science, we're beginning to understand the brain, and we still cannot quite understand what makes a narcissist or what makes a psychopath or what makes a sociopath. We now recognize those are psychological disorders. They're not a form of demonic possession per se. We don't know yet what causes this, but we do know that that some people have an imbalance in their brain chemistry. Some people, you know, have no conscience, or some people have just, it's just interesting to see how you can have two kids raised in the same family and one just goes off the rails and starts killing people and the other one doesn't.
You know, I was talking to Doug Matheson, he's a author, yesterday, and he was talking about his time in Africa, and he met this, he was talking to this one doctor, and the doctor was saying, you know, there's just certain cases you can't help them because, you know, somebody put a hex on them with the voodoo and stuff, and there's nothing we can really do for it. And so he was like, well, tell them to put a hex on me. Let's see what happens. And then he goes, oh, no, you don't want that. It's like, yeah, seriously, what do you think would happen to me? And the guy thought about it, and he goes, you know, probably nothing because you don't believe it, you know. So it's kind of like, I see the lights are kind of going off.
Mm-hmm.
But so I mean, do you agree that if the spiritual world was there, according to Christian theology, that we should see something? We should see some tangible benefits, like haunted houses or anything like that?
Well, I think it depends if you take a cataphatic view of God, where you're wanting to look for the evidence. I think there's a growing group of people who are just interested in embracing the mystery. And in case of embracing the mystery, no, you don't expect to see anything. But I do think the whole notion of, you know, and this is where I really like some of Eddie Izzard's comments. You know, if God was there, why did he stop Hitler? You know, I do think there's a lot of those kind of questions. If there really was a supernatural God that was going to come down and zap, there's plenty of times in history you have to go like, well, why the hell were you? But I do think that for me, I like to take the other approach, where sometimes I just enter into the mystery saying, I don't know what's going on here, but there's something really here that's outside of me, and it's very exciting. Just as I said, especially when I get to be in nature, there's just something there that is definitely beyond me.
Well, I think the thing is, though, I mean, the along the lines, I haven't heard of that word that you mentioned. What was it?
Cataphatic means that you can prove, you know, the existence of something. You know that, you know, you can prove the existence of Jesus with certain proofs, and I'm sure you've seen that a lot in evangelical theology. You know, evidence that demands a verdict. You know, here's the proofs that Jesus...
Yeah, I just never heard that term before. That's kind of interesting. I'll have to look it up. I've never heard that in discussions before. But, Yes, I think I forgot what I was going to say. Oh, I was going to say, like, you know, for example, I come from the aspect, though, that, you know, if things are real, there should be evidence for it. So, for example, in the Bible, you know, it talks about Noah's Ark. So if this was really a true story, it would leave a mark, so to speak, all over the earth. You know, the earth would be marked and marred by this event. And because of the evidence is not there, you know, I think it's very safe to say this thing never happened.
But I think, more importantly, taking the book of Genesis, it is not a scientific document. It was two metaphors that were taken from Babylonian stories penned during the exile. You have to look at why a lot of people were trying to create meaning-making out of the fact that they were living in exile and their communities were completely destroyed. And these myths really helped them to hang on during a very dark period of their life. So I don't want to discount the role that myth can play in our society. I think the work of Bill Moyers here and Joseph Campbell is very interesting in looking at what is the role that myths play in our culture.
But don't we only know that it's a myth because of our scientific understanding? In other words, I believe that the original writers and readers of the Genesis account would have thought it was reality, that God really did create people that way.
Mom, I would say that they were taking a Babylonian myth, but we don't really know what their mindset was back in that time frame. I mean, you really can't, you have to go back in and see, it was a whole different world that operated on a lot of different imagery. I mean, you have to realize people did not start actually reading until, you know, the advent of the Gutenberg press, which is why you have a lot of the medieval churches have windows that depict stories, because this is what they would use as teaching aids because no one was literate. So you it's very difficult to take 21st century thoughts and ideas and extrapolate them onto any other century, because we're in such different spaces. We can learn from the mistakes of history and see what we can learn from. It's very hard to say what exactly were they doing during that time period sometimes.
But I think one thing that might make it obvious is that if you ask yourself, why was this written? Why did they write this? For example, why did they write the origination stories for humans? Where did the humans come from? Where did the earth come from? Where did the universe come from? Why did they write those stories? Because they wanted to teach how they thought everything came to be. So it seems like it's an honest, with their knowledge, that was an honest attempt at trying to explain the world, which is what science does. It's just that they had the wrong answer.
Well, for that time, it was also the fact that when you're living in exile, you need to create your oral stories, because without story, you don't live. I mean, your stories are what keep you going as a people. And I think if you look at, you know, why was something penned at a certain time? You know, what was the rationale and reason behind that? I mean, that's true for me for any piece of artwork or any, you know, poem or play. You know, look at the works of William Shakespeare. It's pretty obvious to see where he's kissing up to the king and who he's trying to offend and who he's not. I mean, you look at, there's a whole lot of fun can be derived by looking at, you know, the context of why something was written and who the intended audience might have been at that time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, Becky, thanks for joining me in my in this discussion today. The point was I wanted to talk a little bit, kind of a heart-to-heart to find out as a person who attended seminary and a person who reports on the news, it's kind of interesting, I think, just to get different attitudes. I'm going to be doing some webcasts also with Christians, and I'm an atheist. I'm a former Christian, so I think it's interesting just for people to talk along and share ideas and try to understand each other. So I think it's just interesting from that aspect.
Sounds fascinating. Well, thank you for inviting me.
Okay. Have a nice night. Talk to you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye.